Hi, welcome to everyone joining us on YouTube and otherwhere. My name is Jane Machak. I'm here on behalf of Brooklyn Public Library's Justice Initiatives team. The Justice Initiatives team at BPL works to service and provide programming for currently and formerly incarcerated patrons and their families. And today's event comes as a part of an ongoing series that we've been partnering with community organizations and agencies to produce series of Know Your Rights and How-To workshops. Recently, we've covered topics around the civil legal system of navigating housing court, surrogates court, custody, and more. And now we have shifted a bit towards not just learning about your rights, but how to actually take action and enable those rights in all different forms, both locally, individually, in your neighborhood, in large scale. So tomorrow we have another workshop around police interaction with Moira Meltzer-Cohen. But today's event, we will focus on the rights to starting a tenants union and how to start your own. We'll talk about COVID eviction protections, rent relief, and recent changes to tenants' rights. And guidelines on talking to your neighbors about your rights and understanding your power as tenants and a coalition of tenants, particularly amidst a pandemic here in New York City. And so we're really glad and grateful to have with us today two wonderful organizers working on behalf of the Housing Justice for All campaign. Sia Weaver is the campaign coordinator of Housing Justice for All, which is a coalition of over 80 groups representing tenants and homeless New Yorkers across the state of New York. Sia has worked together with legislative leaders and community partners to pass transformative tenants' rights policy at the local and state level. And we also have Sumathy Kumar, who is a co-chair of the New York City DSA organization and also a campaign organizer of the Housing Justice for All campaign. So I would like to allow you guys to both introduce yourselves, say a bit about the work you're doing and currently involved in, and what you've been thinking about, and then we can kind of jump right into the current state of play in the context that we want to kind of frame this all in. So Sia, I'll turn it over maybe to you first, introduce yourself.
Sure. So my name is Sia. Thank you for that kind introduction. I've been doing tenant organizing in New York City and New York State for a little over 10 years. Mostly, you know, getting started in Crown Heights, working both with tenants whose buildings are in foreclosure and tenants who want to take their buildings over and convert them into affordable housing. We've done a lot of work. I've done a lot of work through this, like also working on land use issues and development and urban planning and what tenants want to see their neighborhoods look like. And now working with the Housing Justice for All Coalition, which led the fight to strengthen tenants' rights at the state level in 2019, and now is really looking to bring together a movement of people who are impacted by both the sort of rental housing crisis and the lack of tenants' rights, but also people who are currently experiencing homelessness or who have experienced homelessness in the past. We want to build a strong movement that sees everybody as having the right to a home. And so too often it's about whether you can pay for it or we put ourselves in these little boxes where we're talking about, you know, homelessness is over here and we're talking about supportive housing and rental assistance and tenants are over here and we're talking about eviction protections. And we really have been striving to bring these two issues together. And I won't say more right now, but I do want to ask Sumathy to share a little bit when she introduces herself about our collaboration with the Justice Roadmap Coalition and what we're trying to do to bring together the issues of decarceration and housing justice.
Yeah. Hi, everybody. I'm Sumathy. I am the campaign organizer at Housing Justice for All. Before that, I was a tenant organizer in Brooklyn. And yeah, we're doing some pretty exciting stuff. I think specifically around like really building in the idea of organizing in your neighborhood, in your building, and how that is how we enforce our rights as tenants. And we're also working really closely with criminal justice reform organizers in the Justice Roadmap Coalition as a way to like further both of our issues, understanding that like so often we use prisons and jails as an like alternative to actual housing and housing rights. The same thing with healthcare. And so instead of incarcerating our neighbors and our family members, we could actually provide them with the things that they need to survive, like housing. So that's one of the things that we're working on right now, specifically around like this right to organize and protection against eviction, and really tying it to the movement for releasing people from prison and for passing the New York Health Act and guaranteeing healthcare for all. I'll stop there.
Great, thank you so much, both of you, for joining us today. So yeah, maybe we can kind of jump into the idea of, or talking a bit about the COVID eviction protections. And I'll let you guys kind of take it from there. I'm reminded of the quote, just as Sumathy talks, I saw it somewhere and I'm not sure who said it, but that prison and jails are America's largest social housing project. In the instance where when you don't have housing, that's where a lot of the time you're gonna end up in a public social housing project of America. So yeah, that really resonated.
Oh, sad.
Exactly. Yeah, and I mean, that's kind of a framework that we have to work within when considering housing as a human right and a legal right. So yeah, I'd like to turn it over to you guys to kind of give us some of the context that we can be thinking of today's discussion.
Yeah, Sumathy, do you want to talk about the eviction moratorium and the protections that are in place right now? And I can talk a little about rent relief.
Yeah, totally. Just so like, maybe to back up a little bit to about a year ago and the state that we found ourselves in, with everyone losing their jobs or being furloughed, unable to pay rent. The housing movement in New York State did this amazing and incredible job of like very rapidly mobilizing to stop evictions during the pandemic. And so we won the first eviction moratorium in the country, and that lasted for 7 months. No one could get evicted. And since then we've kept pushing. Every single month there was this battle over whether or not to extend it. And we kept winning those extensions. And then we finally won like a legislative eviction moratorium at the end of December. That says that, you know, if you can, if you've been financially impacted by COVID or due to COVID, or if you have a family member or you would be at risk of death or illness because of COVID, you cannot be evicted. And the way it works is that you fill out a form saying that that is true, and then you are protected from eviction once you send it to your landlord and to the court. This is really important, especially in a pandemic, when we're being asked to stay at home, that we stop evictions and we don't let people be displaced, because it goes again, it's contradictory from all the things that the government is telling us. So we won that, and that's really exciting. The hard part is that it expires, that eviction moratorium expires on May 1st. So a lot of the work that we're doing right now is around extending that once again. And this time, you know, instead of these month-to-month extensions, extending it all the way till the end of the pandemic, plus at least 180 days after, because we know like the constant moving of the deadlines and all this stuff just causes like unnecessary anxiety. And so that's one of the big things that we're pushing for Yeah, and I'll pass it over to Sia to talk about rent relief.
Well, thank you. So the eviction moratorium has been an incredible protection during the pandemic, but it has unfortunately a sort of inherently temporary thing. Maybe like long-term, we live in a world without evictions, but in the short term, you know, we're not expecting this to be permanent. But one of our main goals right now is how are we taking the things that we've won during the pandemic and hanging on to them? 2.2 million or 1.2 million New Yorkers are $2.2 billion behind on rent because of the COVID-19 pandemic. And that's just an estimate. The real number is probably much higher. And the truth is that people have been paying their rent with their credit cards or borrowing money from family or going into other types of debt, you know, maybe choosing to pay rent and not pay medical debt that they owe or other sorts of debts or costs of living that accumulate. So we have been fighting for over a year for what we're calling cancel rent, which was a campaign to basically say that that debt should never be evictable. Well, we didn't win that per se, and we wanted that because we wanted easy access for undocumented people. We wanted the barrier to entry to be zero for the tenants, and because we really believe that, you know, in a crisis situation like the one that we're in right now, the best and fastest way to get people aid is to just have it come to people automatically. We didn't win cancel rent necessarily in the most recent New York State budget, but what we did win is we won a massive $2.4 billion rent relief program with money coming from both the federal and the state government. It's a program that both tenants and landlords can apply to get their costs covered and to get their rent arrears cleared. And tenants who are eligible will have their rent covered for up to 15 months. So that's 12 months looking backward, starting on March 20th, 2020, and then 3 months moving forward. The other thing about the program that we're thrilled about is that the program covers undocumented people, which is a huge change from the state's last rent relief program. So if you are undocumented or if you are otherwise ineligible for federal rent relief in previous iterations, which includes people who have been incarcerated in the past, you will be eligible for this rent relief program, which is a huge victory. And then the last thing about it is it includes a rent freeze for a full year. So one of the things that we've been really organizing against is the possibility that landlords could just try and double or triple the rent to make up the money that they weren't able to get in the last year during the pandemic. So this is one of the most impactful and progressive rent relief programs in the country. A sign of the strong and organized tenant movement in New York. But the truth is people have not yet gone back to work. We're still behind on rent. And so we're really gonna have to figure out how we organize and how we move forward and keep building our movement to keep winning more things. The rent relief program is not yet up or public yet, but you can keep an eye on the Office of Temporary and Disability Assistance's website. They're the ones who are going to be running the program. And you can also keep an eye on our website, www.housingjusticeforall.org. You can get directed to the eviction moratorium form that Sumathy was describing there, as well as if you follow us on Twitter or Instagram, you can get connected to us there as well. I guess also Facebook, although we tend to be less good at updating our Facebook.
Thank you. That's all really helpful for contextualizing today's discussion and kind of looking backwards and looking forwards for eligible tenants and those who don't see themselves as eligible yet, but have many options for navigating that we can kind of get into. So in terms of kind of jumping into tenant organizing 101, feel free, those of you who are watching with us, to kind of pose any questions as we go or to post them towards the end, whatever you're thinking about when it comes up. So we just wanted to jump right in with the question of what is tenant organizing kind of as a basic definition and how does one kind of do it? If we can kind of take that as a two-pronged question, but yeah, first getting into what exactly is it?
Yeah. So tenant organizing is people coming together around their housing, either in their building or on their block, to try and build power together to pressure either the landlord or whoever is in charge, really, to get the things that they need. And so it's really, you know, the same way that people organize in their workplace to win things from their bosses. Tenants can organize too in their homes to win things from their landlords. And so really that is what it is at its most like basic core. And it can win like a ton of different things. So like anything from, you know, your stove is broken and you've called your landlord for like hundreds of times and they still haven't done anything, or your rent is too high and your landlord's overcharging you, or the building is breaking down or whatever it is. So many times when you call on your own or you try and make these things better as an individual, it just doesn't work, because as an individual, as a tenant, you just don't have that kind of individual power over your landlord. But then when there's the ability to join together with other tenants who are facing the same things, you just have more, you have more power because you have more people, and you can really exert control over your own housing situation, which is ultimately all of our goals, right? That we can determine what goes on in our own homes.
Yeah, I think that's exactly right. And it's just such an impactful way to both win change directly from the landlord and to win change directly from policymakers. It is just the fundamental building block of whoever your target is. It's the precondition for being able to change the world.
And so going from there, kind of how does one get involved in doing this at a basic level of just, you know, organizing around advocating for rights within the building, broken fixtures or whatnot, all the way up to, you know, rental and financial changes to the building as a whole? But where does one start, and kind of how would one get started in organizing?
The first step is always to talk to people. So if you, depending on like where you want to organize, you know, say you live in a building, the first step would be to talk to the other people in your building or the other people on your block, and ask them like, are you going through the same things that I'm going through? I'm dealing with this thing, it's a huge problem. I tried to do this and that. And, you know, if it's happening to you, it's probably happening to your neighbors. And so by talking to them, see if other people want to get involved and start organizing. And then usually the next step is just to meet all together and to like pool all of the problems that you're going through and see the common themes, come up with like what you want to see collectively change. And then it's a little harder. And then you have to you have to start pressuring the landlord, and that can look like a whole bunch of things.
Yeah, I think just some other things that you could add, right? Sumathy's exactly right. The tenant organizing is at its core. The way that you get started is just talking to your neighbors and bringing people together under their shared interests. And some of the other things you might want to do or ask when you're first getting started are like, has this block been organized before? Has there been a tenant association in this building before? Especially if you're new to the building, I know, you know, we organize with a multiracial, multigenerational class of
group of tenants and have been successful at building tenant associations that both represent newer, often whiter, often younger residents in the same group that of like older people of color, often older women who represent the building. But one of the things I always like to say, if you, especially if you're newer to the neighborhood and you're going door knocking, is you should say like, hey, have you been in a union before? Have you been in a tenant association before? Is there a Black association here that has been meeting? If yes, are you part of it? If no, would you want there to be one? Just some very basic mapping questions can be really helpful at the beginning to just get the lay of the land as you get started organizing, because we're not really trying to reinvent the wheel. So that's one thing. And then a second thing is, you know, if there is someone in the building who is a leader and they have followers, you might want to talk to them first. And you might want to be like, hey, I'd really like to be involved in the tenant association. Can we set the agenda together? Blah, 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 blah. But yeah, I think that one of the things that's really wonderful about Brooklyn and is wonderful about New York City in general is that there's like a long history of labor organizing and just organizing in general. So a lot of times what we've found in the housing movement is that some of the best tenant leaders are people who are like really amazing at organizing because they were maybe a shop steward and now they're retired, or they had some sort of like previous history or experience with using collective action to win things. Yeah, but that's a good way to get started. And I think some of the challenges are retaliation from the landlord. That is going to happen. But the thing is that New York City renters actually do have the right to organize and to form a union in your building. And that's something you always have to keep in mind.
And just asking a question that kind of has come to my mind as we're talking about this is in terms of, you know, organizing in your community, if your landlord only owns, you know, your building with three units in it compared to corporate property management companies that oversee six buildings in Brooklyn with nine units in each one, is there kind of a difference in, you know, is there like a building that's too small or a building that's too big for you to kind of start working around versus, you know, it being privately owned by a family versus a company owning it and managing it on behalf of an overseas landlord or something. But yeah, kind of, you know, what makes it too big versus too small of a fight to take on?
I would say that there's no building too small and no building too big. Everyone can organize. There are like structural limitations though in New York because not everybody has the same kind of rights. So people who live in rent stabilized buildings have far more protection from organizing and from pressuring their landlord from the retaliation that comes with that. But people who live in unregulated buildings should also be organizing. And that's why one of the biggest things that Housing Justice for All is fighting for right now is good cause eviction. Which would give people across the state, regardless of how big their unit is or what regulatory agreement it's under, everybody would get the right to organize, the right to a renewal lease, and freedom from unjust rent increases, which would totally change the landscape of like what is possible in terms of tenant organizing. Because it's really hard if you feel like you're gonna get evicted, if you complain, to really get organizing going in a small unregulated building. It doesn't mean it's impossible and people should definitely do it, but that's part of why we're fighting for good cause eviction right now.
Yeah, and one of the things that we've seen is, we just know that corporate landlords pursue evictions more aggressively and raise the rent more aggressively. They have management companies and lawyers, and they know every loophole in the law, and they exploit it, and they have the resources to go after you, you know, when you're like 2 days behind on rent. And So as gentrification is sort of sweeping through our city, what we're seeing is mom and pop landlords and small homeowners are being bought out by corporate landlords. And the COVID-19 pandemic has been making that worse. That consolidation of the real estate market means that tenant organizing is more important than ever before. And the truth is that, you know, just because a building has four units in it doesn't mean the landlord is small. It could be that landlord owns, you know, hundreds of four unit apartment buildings across the city. And so mapping out what other things your landlords might own is a really useful thing to do when you're getting started organizing. There's an amazing website called Who Owns What, and I wanna drop it in the chat, and I don't know if that will make it over to the YouTube comments or if that's possible.
Yeah, I can share anything you put in here, I can add to the YouTube chat.
Okay, cool. I'm just gonna drop this website in the chat. This is an enormously useful, unfortunately it's just New York City right now, but they're working to expand it across the state. This website is really helpful when you're first getting started tenant organizing, because with this website, you can look up who your landlord is, and you can look up who their investors are, who's the lender on your building. It can tell you how many code violations are there. It will tell you what are the other buildings your landlord owns. It will tell you who your political representatives are. And so this is basically one way you can open up that website, and it's just what it's telling you is, like, if you're an organized tenant association, these are the points of leverage you have. You can go after their bankers. You can go after your representatives and get them to stand with you. You can say, wow, you've got 30 code violations on a 10-unit building. That's illegal, and we're going to go after you in the press for that. So Who Owns What is just a really useful tool to uncover what potential handles you might have as a tenant organizer to really hold your landlord to account.
Yeah, great shout. I've perused Who Owns What quite a few times. Like my own building, my friend's building. I think I've bugged everyone in my life with being like, did you know this? And they're like, yeah, I didn't know that. But it was all new to me at one point. So then kind of getting in deeper of why is tenant organizing considered one of the best ways about to enforce and know about your rights? You know, why tenant organizing versus independently just you and maybe your own house taking action against something? Why is it that this collective organizing effort can be so effective?
Yeah, I mean, you'll always have more power when there's more people. And I think that we see that all the time, right? When people, you know, try and take action on their own and it doesn't feel like it's going anywhere and no one's listening to you. And then when you join with like more and more people, either just in your building or like Sia said, in the other buildings that your landlord owns, or just like with tenants across the state, you can build all this power and have more people so that you represent a real threat to the landlord or to your elected official or whoever it is. And so it really does help to have more people. And then the other thing I will say about like enforcing your rights is just that the government just does not always do a good job of enforcing the laws that they pass. And that's really sad. And there's a lot of different reasons for it, but it just ends up working out that the people who are organized and the people who are communicating with their neighbors, who have an organization that can exert pressure, are going to be able to enforce the laws that are being passed way more than just them by themselves, or if they just were waiting for the city to come around and do an inspection. And if you join together with all your neighbors and like start calling all together, then maybe the city agency will come out and do an inspection or whatever it is you want. But it's really, really hard to do that if you're just doing it by yourself.
Yeah, I want to give like an example. And this is one of my favorite examples to give, rent and fraud. And at the state housing agency, it's called the Division of Housing and Community Renewal. They're supposed to collect rents. Collect registered rents. Your landlord collects your rent, but they're supposed to obtain a data of what the legally registered for each apartment is. And they're supposed to investigate when your landlord doesn't the rules or might be overcharging. And truth is that they won a tremendous amount of political pressure at HCR to pick out the simplest case. You know, it'll be a rent overcharge where all the paperwork complaining about it is this big or this big. They'll pick the small one because it's easier and they'll just rubber snap deny it. The other truth of it is that agency has been overwhelmingly underfunded by Governor Cuomo. And that's a political choice, right? That Cuomo has made that agency completely inoperative for tenants so that it can operate better for landlords. So there's like a choice to force the wheels of government to not exactly work for tenants who are unorganized. And then the last thing about all of that is that, you know, you'll hear politicians say like, oh, you know, it's not fraud. It's not corruption. It's just government bureaucracy, never going to work. And the truth is like, that's a choice. I think that corruption and fraud really often looks much more boring and than like bags of money being handed to somebody. It actually looks like a rent overcharge that gets closed, even though a tenant has been paying like 4 to 5 times the legal rent for years. And so the only way you're going to like sort of pierce through that and create the political will for the laws to be enforced is if you are organized at multiple levels. The last thing is like a lot of times the things that we're fighting for are technically legal. I think a lot of the tenant harassment that people experience is on just of the law. So you can't go after your landlord in court because you'd probably lose. You can't go after your landlord at HCR because you might lose. Organizing gives you the power and the opportunity to win things that the law is not going to provide you with. And so it's really impactful to have a tenant association say, we're not going to pay the rent until you fix this leak on the roof for the whole building. And that's going to move a lot faster than the court will. The court is going to want other stuff. So organizing is how you create the economic power to force your landlord to act.
Thanks so much. And so how can you really kind of get started then with talking to your neighbors about the eviction moratoriums and rent relief? Or, you know, if you have a relatively like decent sized building, but there's just one or two neighbors who just really aren't on board, what are kind of some ways to find that, you know, initial common ground to get started in these conversations that you've experienced or heard be successful? As jumping off points.
Yeah, I mean, it's hard. Sometimes you're not going to be able to convince everybody. And I don't think it's even really about convincing them. It's really about like finding out what they're going to respond to and what they want right now. Maybe some people are happy with their current housing situation. But I think most people aren't because the housing is in New York is not so great. And so whatever it is, maybe it's not the issue that you're facing, but maybe it's something else. And that is what's going to bring your neighbor into the fight. And it's really about asking the questions that are going to get them to tell you and get them to like share and get them to realize that you will be more powerful together. And so I would like strongly encourage, I think the best way to like have a good and door knocking conversation, like having your first organizing conversation should be like mostly you just asking questions about the person that you're trying to organize, like what's going on in their apartment, is there anything that is like an issue for them? How long have they lived in the building or lived in the neighborhood? And have they complained to their landlord about the problem and what happened? And if nothing happened, like ask them why they think nothing happened and try and like ask the questions that are gonna get them to like come to the realization themselves that it's in their best interest to join with their neighbors and organize. Yeah, that's all I'll say for now.
Yeah, and I think another thing I would add is it can be really helpful to like map out the building. And so you're gonna meet someone who's like maybe cautiously interested, but not that excited and they don't know. And maybe you're like, I just want you to come to the first meeting. Just come and check it out and you'll see. And then you might meet someone who's like, yes, I like used to run the tenant association. I got really tired, but I really want to help you getting it all together again. And they have a lot of institutional knowledge, but maybe they burnt themselves. They were just trying to do it all themselves. And so you got to like figure out what you're going to do to create some structures in your TA so that people don't get burned out. And that could happen with any organization. And then, you know, contradictory, right? Because the point is to bring more people into organization and more people into politics, but there are just going to be some people that you're not going to get. And don't break your back trying to convince someone who slammed the door in your face. Like if you have an 8-unit building and you've got 6 apartments meeting regularly, that is awesome. If you have 100 and you're having 50% tenant association meetings, that is like really also amazing. The perfect be the enemy of those is the ultimate advice.
Awesome. Yeah, that's really good to hear from and hear about. You know, it doesn't have to be every single person who's living in the building, and you know, kind of the majority that's with you is the strongest kind of companions you're going to have in that fight. And so, yeah, we can either kind of get into further questions now, or if you guys want to talk about kind of the upcoming struggles you have with housing justice for all, we can do either or first. I have a few questions still that I'd like to ask you guys, but whatever you guys.
Yeah, let's go through the rest of the questions and then let's talk about like some next steps and our upcoming events and campaigns where people can get involved. And I'm also going to wrap one more thing in the chat. This is a guide for how to get started with organizing your building that, sorry for the gross looking link, but New York City DSA put this together, but it's really good. It is really good and gives you a little bit of some guide, some quote, some like sample scripts for what your first conversation should look like, and a sample flyer for your first meeting, as well as some case studies. So it's definitely a really useful resource.
Amazing. Thank you so much. It's been added to the YouTube chat for anyone watching. And I realize I could have like asked this for clarity earlier as I was mentioning property management, but could you guys just briefly go over kind of what the differences or different challenges are that come up when organizing in a building that's property managed compared to something that's privately owned or like a more mom and pop landlord status? Like what are some of the struggles that come up in fighting a management company versus the actual owner of the building?
Yeah. It's hard. I think one of the biggest challenges, and this happened in a building in Crown Heights that I was working with a few years ago, but the landlord, when we first started organizing in it, was a very small landlord. He owned about 4 buildings or 6 buildings or so, and we were organizing in 4 of them, and we were doing a good job. And then he maybe sold the building, but also he didn't sell the building. And then a management company came in, and they were really fancy, and very like, I don't know, larger scale. And the hardest thing, and I think this is always true in organizing, like you want to know who your target is, like who has the power to give you the thing that you want. And with a management company, it's sometimes hard to know who is your target. Like, is it the person who ultimately like owns the property, or is it the person who's managing it or the company that's managing it? So that can be a challenge. And the way I think that you find out who your target is by organizing and pressuring both people and being like, who is going to give me an answer? I'm going to keep bothering all of you until you tell me who is going to take responsibility for this building. And that's what happened in the building I was working in. The tenants organized, they started a lawsuit, they sued both the management company and the landlord. And then all of a sudden, both people were like, no, we don't own the building. I don't know what you're talking about. The landlord owns the building. And then the landlord was like, no, I sold the building. And so that is like a helpful way to like really get to the heart of it by just like bothering both people a lot. You can escalate, you don't have to start right away with a court case. But as soon as you start to put pressure on people, the people who don't have the responsibility are gonna like be like, bye, never mind, it's not me.
And it's always important too to think about who is the real target sending to throw you off the trail, which can also really happen. There is a whole organization in New York that landlords hire to go basically de-escalate tenant associations. And they say, oh yeah, we'll help you fill out this paperwork, or we'll help the, if you fill out this paperwork, the landlord will be able to get a tax abatement, so the rent increase won't be so high. And they pretend like they're on your side, but really what they're doing is just union busting the TA. And landlords hate organized tenant groups. And so they'll be really sneaky and they'll say, no, like, you don't need to fight collectively. Like, what's your problem? I'm going to come in and fix it. Like, don't worry about the tenant association. It'll be better if you just let me fix it one-on-one. Or they'll send like a social worker or family services or whatever to your apartment to try and like identify your needs and meet them. And so a lot of times your target will try to like bring someone in who's going to try and de-escalate the situation. That is a role the property manager could play. It's a role certain nonprofits could play. But it's something to think about when you're doing the power mapping. And something, you know, we love to really power map out our targets. And so you want to start when you're building your tenant union. It's like, what are our goals here? Are our goals to stop evictions? Okay, who can make that happen? Maybe it's the legislature. Maybe it's the landlord directly. Maybe it's the court. Who do they care about? What moves them? And start to ask yourself the questions about like, what power do we have that can move the people who actually are the target? And often the first thing that happens when a tenant association gets really powerful and organized is the landlord sells the building. They're just like, not worth it. So I think an organized tenant association costs a landlord a ton of money.
Mm. Yeah, you start to see a lot of overlaps between kind of the enemies and the mapping of, you know, tenant unionizing along with anything else within like labor organizing, where, you know, bosses and company owners start getting really scared by collective unity. And another question is how do rights around organizing differ in public housing and government controlled housing, or even subsidized housing? But are tenants' rights different there around management of the buildings and ownership of them?
Yeah, if anything, they're stronger. So in public housing, for example, there are chartered resident management associations, and they're resident associations that are paid to exist, but with government money, which is a good thing. And there's a sort of like nod to the commitment for tenant leadership and governance in the direction of public housing. So there's something called the Citywide Council of Presidents, which is a board of tenant association leaders at every NYCHA building in the city that is supposed to be asked for input on the direction of NYCHA. The reality is that these positions have become sort of seats of political patronage. NYCHA buildings don't often have like competitive TA elections. Often the TAs are really sort of beat down. And it just becomes like sort of like a slush fund for the local district leader or whoever wants to like control this like small corner of politics. And that's why organizing is so important, because if NYCHA TAs were, I mean, I don't know, it's hard to do a counterfactual, but I think public housing is one of the strongest forms of social housing that there is. But the problem with NYCHA, which is, I just want to like shout out NYCHA for being some of the last public housing in our country. The problem and the problem with the conditions is because it has been demobilized. So the TAs have sort of fake representation. They have a seat at the table, but they don't have any power at the table. And the way that they would have power at the table, I think, is if they were organized enough to say, hey, we're having elections every year. We do vote as a Black, and we're a democratic organization at our building, and we are gonna, let's put it this way. If NYCHA residents voted as a Black, they could choose the next mayor. And that's not really happening, right? It's really organized. You have tenant association presidents who don't really represent anybody. And so to be the leader of a tenant association, you actually have to have followers, and many of them don't. Many of them are just sort of vestiges of like a sort of old political machine. And that means not an organized group of people that are demanding better living conditions for public housing. I'm starting to change. There are a number of organizations, including Justice for All, CAV, Residents to Save Public Housing, Community Voices Heard, who are really turning to this, and you know, and Movement School, which is doing a really cool NYCHA Fellows project, that are really turning to this question of like, what would it be like to take these tenant associations in NYCHA and public housing and make them real and make them like a function of shared governance with the public housing agency. And so the Green New Deal for public housing, which is a bill that was introduced by AOC in Congress last year, and might actually have some legs in this new upcoming infrastructure package, doesn't just give money to the very beleaguered housing authority. It also like really supercharges the tenant associations. It puts a lot of resources into making sure the TAs have competitive elections annually, have the resources to make a difference in their buildings, and gives them a real seat at the table. So the question of social housing is solved by really two things, like what's democratic governance and what's the resources and the laws that we need to have it. And we can't have democratic governance through structures. We only have that through organizing and like constant elections and like constant engagement. There's a really good book about the civil rights movement that I really recommend everybody read, mostly for the title. It's called Freedom is an Endless Meeting. And it's just so true, unfortunately. I'm sorry. And now it's on Zoom.
Who wrote that, do you know, off the top of your head?
Yeah, one sec. Let me just grab it and put it in the chat.
Yeah, I'd love to check that out. We usually ask ask our panelists by the end of our panels a book recommendation anyway. So I'm glad you beat us to it with that one.
Sumathy and I are making a reading list for Housing Justice for All, so we have plenty.
Oh, perfect. Francesca Paletta, cool. see. Great. Thank you. I was taking notes while we were talking there. And yes, so kind of as you were talking about, you know, organizing around a coalition of groups and the involvement of nonprofits, and even kind of at the beginning when you made comments of kind of the overlap between tenants' rights and protecting yourself, and the fight around homeless rights for homeless individuals in the project of justice, housing justice for all. So if maybe you guys would want to talk a bit about how does, you know, tenant organizing for people who are currently in buildings and currently have housing, how does organizing with one's building overlap with the current struggles of homeless individuals and shelter residents in the city and around the state? But yeah, why does the housing justice not only just protect the rights of people who are currently in houses, current tenants, but how does this kind of empower, or how can we bring in those who are currently the most vulnerable without residency or with very precocious residency?
Yeah, it's so important, right? It's so like what Sia was saying at the beginning, that we're so often just talking about these issues separately, even though they're the same problem. We have we have 92,000 homeless New Yorkers across the state right now. And that is in part because of the real estate industry and our governor's like failure to do anything about it, right? And so tenants and homeless New Yorkers have the same enemies and also the same like vision for like what the world we want to see is, right? And so it is so important to organize like side by side to make sure that we're not leaving people out when we're fighting for whatever it is, and that we're thinking about the problem beyond just our buildings, but people who've been evicted already, who no longer have homes, and how are we organizing with those folks? And so in Housing Justice for All, and I think we can talk about this a little bit more when we get to next steps, but we really think it's important to end homelessness and to give people permanent housing so that they can be able, well, first so that they can have homes and also so that people can be organizing to like continue to enforce their rights. And so one of the things that we're fighting for is the Housing Access Voucher Program, which would give people the ability to move into permanent housing if they're homeless. And to me, it really goes along with the idea of tenant organizing. In our ideal world, no wouldn't, no one would be homeless, right? Everybody would have a home and everybody would have control over where they lived in some way democratically. And that means that we have to organize everybody to win that. So, yeah.
Yeah. And one thing that I would just add to what Sumathy laid out is that homelessness is incredibly marginalized in our society, but it's not a permanent condition. And so when someone has a home, they're not homeless anymore. And that's just more people to build the tenant power movement. And also that there is a lot of homelessness that is invisibilized. So it's really possible that you're going to build a tenant association, and one of the people who's active in your TA is someone who's like living on the couch with their sister because they were evicted and didn't have anywhere to go. And so, or maybe the person in your TA is like a 22-year-old, graduated from college, grew up in Brooklyn, can't afford to live in the neighborhood, but all their family and connections are here. And so you wouldn't like call someone who's staying with their family homeless, but you know, that's not like a normal way to live. We're not living in a way where everybody has dignity. And so I think if we sort of broaden our imaginations and try and really build connections between, you know, people who are homeless don't look the way that everyone assumes that they do. It's my point, I guess. You know, there's a lot of invisible homelessness. There's a lot of people who are working two jobs and who are homeless. There's a lot of people who are employed by the city and living in the city's shelters. And so if we can broaden out how we're thinking about this, it's really easy to tell that we're all in the same movement.
Thanks so much. Just to follow up on that point, reach like a bit into the shelter system. If you don't know, don't worry. But for those who suffer from chronic vulnerable housing, find themselves frequently in shelters, not, you know, susceptible to a certain landlord or property manager, because they don't, you know, they're not on a lease, they don't live with anyone. What kind of are steps that you could take to get them involved in a fight for housing when, you know, they might not have personally a direct target, if they don't have their own landlord or they're just staying in a, you know, a public shelter?
Yeah, so there's organizations we work really closely with, both the Safety Net Project, Vocal New York, and Neighbor, as well as Picture the Homeless, are all organizations that have done a lot of work to build a union of homeless New Yorkers who is demanding dignity where they stay and they live. And so sometimes that looks like your target is a city and the dignity that you're seeking is to get out of congregate shelters and into hotels. So the Homeless Can't Stay Home campaign is a good example of this, where what homeless folks were coming together to demand from the target, being at this point the mayor, solo hotel rooms where they could stay safe from COVID-19. In other cases, and Picture the Homeless has done a really good job of this, the city has outsourced care for the homeless to not-for-profits. And I think it's important to remember that not-for-profits are not like inherently good. And I want to ask Sumathy to share a little bit about her time organizing in Brownsville in a second. But a lot of times, people who are homeless are living in apartment buildings under a contract from a shelter provider. And the shelter provider is just the one who happens to have the lease. And so maybe there's someone who's homeless who's like in a shelter, and the shelter is just that apartment that's right next door to you. And so that really exists. The de Blasio administration attempted to pivot away from that, but it's still so prevalent, especially in, you know, parts of Brownsville. There's like entire streets that Sumathy can tell you about it. I won't share, but I'm going to ask you to in a second. And then the third thing is that, you know, because we've done that, there are some really big, really corrupt corporate shelter providers. And one of them is HelpUS. HelpUSA is run by Andrew Cuomo's sister and her husband, Kenneth Cole, of the clothing company. And I'm not even joking. It's funny, but it's also true. And so, like, you know, these are millionaires who are running shelters where homeless folks die every year, and they're running them with huge government contracts. And so there's actually a lot of ways that, like, there is both a government target and a corporate target that homeless folks come together and organize against. I want to ask Sumathy to talk a little bit about like the scattered site problem and what happens in some parts of the city.
I think that's really right. And so the city or the state decided in some ways to outsource sheltering people. And they decided to do that in neighborhoods that have been like chronically disinvested in, like Brownsville, which is where I used to organize. And the way they would do it is they would go to landlords, go to private landlords and offer higher amounts of money than the market rate or the rent stabilized rate, to house people. And sometimes those folks just needed a place to stay. And other times they really need like far more services than just being in an apartment building alone without any like care. And so in both cases, the city seemed to be going to landlords who were bad, where the conditions of the buildings were terrible, and where those people who were formerly or currently homeless had absolutely no rights to organize or to do anything to advocate for themselves. And it's sort of, you know, complicated and a little like hard to explain, but it's because those nonprofits that Sia was talking about earlier were the ones who hold the leases. And so instead of just having an apartment, living in your home, you're like a subtenant, and you have like very few rights and can't enforce any of them. Because if you complain, the nonprofit will simply like move you to some other place without telling you. And you just have no control over your housing. And at the same time, those buildings are maybe like 40% people who are from homeless shelters or part of the nonprofits, and then 60% tenants, rent stabilized tenants, and everyone's conditions are terrible, and no one can organize with each other because of all of these barriers. So it's a really terrible situation, right? And the answer is always organizing, and the answer is always tenants need more rights. Homeless New Yorkers need more rights. And also like we need to actually care for people and like provide actual resources to house people and not depend on like slumlords to house our like most vulnerable populations in our city, which is what is happening right now. And so when you like think about all of that, then you see the connections really easily. And it's like, of course people need to organize together. Of course homeless New Yorkers and tenants need to organize together, because we're all being like put in the same situation to like varying degrees of severity. And the problem is that the government and the real estate industry just do not care about providing people with like actual housing. So yeah,
it's bad. And they profit immensely. I mean, these landlords that Sumathy is talking about will get, you know, like $5,000 or $10,000 or $8,000 a month for a 3-bedroom in Brownsville, which is way above the market rate. And then stick 8 people in it and run it like it's a mini little shelter. It's really terrible and bad for renters, bad for people who are tenants of that building. And one thing that it really does that becomes an organizing challenge that you have to learn to overcome when you're organizing is it pits tenants against each other. So long-term tenants will say, I hate living here because they just turned this building into a shelter, and like, you know, say really unkind things about the homeless families who have moved in, and vice versa, you know? So thinking about the kinds of housing that could provide people with the real services they need, and also the kinds of the way that a tenant association, like this is really silly. It's not that deep, but it's just like a tenant association can help people like see the humanity in each other, which is really important for actually the world that we envision includes dignity for everybody and an end to like racism and classism and sexism. And all of that requires that we be in more spaces with each other in shared struggle. So the TAs actually really help, you know, eliminate the unconscious and conscious biases that people have against the homeless.
Yeah, just as like a quick anecdote to add to that, that made me think of, as we're talking about Help USA in the nonprofit world, is I remember a while ago, I remember seeing like a job description posted by, it was Help USA for a career with them that was some monitoring role. And just the language of the listing was, you know, you're patrolling the building, you're regulating the behavior, you're monitoring the environment and the residents. And it all kind of reminds you of this language around policing and where you're going to a place to call it your home and you're being surveilled and policed by people who are making money off of being in your building to watch you. And that creates a much different experience of safety and security in your residency versus having neighbors that you feel comfortable talking to about issues that come up and having an association that you feel confident in addressing, you know, legal issues that may come up for you or your neighbors. And just how there are such better ways to create a sense of empowerment and a sense of security in your neighborhood and in your building, rather than creating an environment of policing and surveillance that a lot of, you know, government and nonprofit environments in the shelter system and elsewhere can, you know, intentionally or unintentionally provoke, even just in kind of the way that they cast out people to recruit inward to kind of help with these projects. And yeah, I don't see if you have a comment about that. But beyond that, I'd love to kind of shift now into talking about the next steps and ways to get involved with housing justice and struggles in New York and kind of upcoming struggles and campaign that you guys are working on. And then we can talk about that a little bit before we take any questions that come from our audience members watching in the chat.
Maybe let's just start by saying what we're doing tomorrow. Do you want to share about the event tomorrow, Sumathy?
Yeah. So tomorrow we are both in Foley Square in Manhattan and in Rochester. We're going to be doing a joint press conference with both the New York Health Act and the Justice Roadmap Coalition on this intersection of housing, healthcare, and decarceration. And I'm really excited about it. It's going to be at 10 at Foley Square tomorrow. So folks to come out to that. And it's really a way for us to launch our campaign for good cause, eviction. And again, like I said before, this campaign is really just about the right to organize and the right to stay in your homes. And that along with the Housing Access Voucher Program are gonna be like two huge priorities for us over the next few months. Because in this last state budget that was really progressive, that we won a lot of things. The thing that we didn't win on at all was homelessness. And our state legislature just totally abdicated responsibility of taking, of dealing with the homelessness crisis. Those two things are gonna be huge priorities over the next 8 or so weeks.
And just in terms of getting involved, you can always go to our website and sign up for our mailing list. We have regular sort of like public meetings for people who want to be involved in the fight, where we talk about what's the update from Albany, how you can get involved both at the building level and at the local, both at the building level, the neighborhood level, your city level, or, you know, if you want to get on the bus and come with us to Albany to do some lobbying yourself. So I would really encourage folks to sign up, and I'll drop our website in the chat right now so it can get converted over to the YouTube. And the other thing is, I'm gonna put our email in the chat too. If you are like, I really wanna get started organizing, but I really don't know where to begin, you should email us. That's our email address. And what we can do is we can either give you a toolkit and some support in setting up a tenant union where you live, or if there's already a tenant union where you live, we can connect you to them and link you up with an organizer. Or if you are experiencing homelessness and wanna get connected to the groups that are working on homelessness, we can do that as well. So if you are listening to this webinar and you're like, wow, organizing is what I need to do, please reach out and we can connect you to the right people. And the last thing that people definitely need to do is get themselves protected from eviction. So I'm just going to put that in the chat one more time.
as well. Wonderful. We'll connect all of that to the YouTube chat. And so for now, I want to open it up to questions from those watching. I have a few questions here that have been sent over to me. And we can just go through them as they come in. But one question that comes up is, what is the difference between stabilized and non-stabilized housing? And does it have an effect on forming a tenants union? I know you mentioned earlier that rent stabilized buildings tend to have more rights or protections, but if you want to kind of get into maybe what some of those are compared to non-stabilized housing.
Yeah, so in New York City and a few counties outside of it, we have rent stabilization and it applies to buildings that are over 60 units and that were built before 1974. So a lot of buildings, but also not a lot of buildings, not all the buildings. And it means that you have the right to a renewal lease, and every year there is a rent guidelines board that is like appointed by the mayor that votes to decide how much your rent should be increased, how much every rent stabilized tenant's rent should be increased. And so in that way, you're sort of, your rent stays a little stable. And you also just have this entire infrastructure of the state that is supposed to help you enforce your rights, make sure that your conditions are good in your housing, that your rent is not going over, like Sia said earlier, all of these things. And so it's really good. It's like an amazing program. It's basically universal depending on whether you live in the right building. And it is the reason that like people can stay in their homes for like decades and decades in New York City. So it's definitely easier, I think, to organize your building if it's rent stabilized. You just have more protections because you know that you have the right to a renewal lease. You know that you have the right to like, you know, incremental rent increases. Your landlord actually doesn't get to control how much your rent goes up. Someone else does. And so there are just more protections. But that doesn't mean that people who aren't unregulated can't organize a tenant association. It just means that it might be a little harder, but it's still like incredibly valuable and important, and will make the act of organizing will make you more protected no matter like what the rights are. Because you will have a group of people who are going to back you up. So yeah, I don't know if you want to add anything to that.
I think that's right. All tenants have the right to organize, but in practice, it's harder to enforce if your landlord can just retaliate against you. But some tips to make it easier are to leave the building, find more people, form a block association instead, and definitely down to think through that if anyone wants to try and take that on. So email us. The thing I have to add is please email us.
Yeah, any Q&As can be expanded on by a quick email. Another question that comes in is, what kind of legal entity is a tenants union? Can it legally represent individual tenants?
It really depends on the tenant union you set up. There's no rules. I would say the most important rule is to make sure that it's open to everybody. There's democratic decision-making, and that can look like whatever you want. I work with some tenant associations that have formed a 501c3, like the Stuytown Peter Cooper Village Tenant Association, and they have annual elections, and they raise money from foundations, and they represent the tenants of Stuytown Peter Cooper Village, and they're a nonprofit, and they have lawyers that they hire to represent their whole building and the tenants who live in it. And then there's other tenant associations that we work with that are, you know, 20 unit building, and it's an informal group of people who meet every Thursday in the building lobby. So there's no hard and fast rules, and you should do whatever works for you and the group of people. The only rule is that you should meet regularly, and you should have some sort of conversation about how you're making decisions to represent the whole.
Great. And the last question I have that has come in is, what role can tenants unions play in zoning and development issues at community boards?
So much. I mean, tenants are constituents, and they're constituents that are often overlooked in the zoning and land use fights, because our entire structure of democratic governance is around property owners. But community boards are a place where organized people can make sure that their voices are heard. I would say, like, to go back to that targeting that Sumathy talked about at the beginning, the community board is not a decision-making body. That's an advisory body. And almost everyone on the community board is a homeowner or a landlord. And so that's just something to think about, is how the various structures of participatory governance we have created reflect not tenants. I would say a better use of an organized tenant association's time is to, like, take it directly to where the power is, which is with the council member. But any organized group of people can and regularly does exert their vision for land use and development, fight outsized rezonings, fight unaffordable housing, call for deeper affordability in proposed projects. That happens every single day in our city. Again, I would say community board, that's a distraction. Focus on the council member, that's where the power is. And also, you know, tenants, y'all should get involved in the upcoming council races, because the council is gonna have a huge say over what the future of development looks like in our city. Putting on my DSA hat now, which Sumathy and I are both members, that Sumathy's a co-chair of, and I'm also involved with. We've endorsed 6 candidates who have a really powerful vision for how land use could look differently in New York City. They are also committed to the struggle for tenant justice. Many of them are either tenant organizers themselves or came out of the housing movement, especially Mike Hollingsworth, who's done some of these Brooklyn Public Library panels with me in the past. He's amazing. Will be my council member, and Adolfo Abreu, who is fighting to represent a city council district in the Bronx and comes out of the Northwest Bronx Community Encouragement Coalition. Both Adolfo and Mike come directly out of the housing movement and are running for city council because of the way that tenants' voices have been ignored in land use decisions for the last 8 to 10 years or forever. So excited to put them in office, and y'all should definitely volunteer for their campaigns. Let me try and find the link. And then I'll put that in the chat too. Do you know, Sumathy? I'll find it.
I'll find it too.
Okay. Here you go. Here's how you can get involved. Yeah.
Great, thank you. Yeah, we're huge fans of Mike Hollingsworth. We've had some really amazing local advocates to shout out Sarah Farrah Forest. We've had Jabari Brisport with us a couple times. So there's really amazing leadership here within Brooklyn. And your councilmen or your, you know, local organizers are usually really accessible, and if you can't get a hold of them, get a hold of us, because we might be trying to get a hold of them too for panels. So yeah, thank you for plugging those. And on the note of the I know you guys had mentioned earlier the Justice Roadmap, next week actually our Justice Initiatives team has partnered with the team behind the Justice Roadmap to produce a panel discussion on the state of justice in New York in the 7-part legislative agenda that'll help us reach a more just and equitable future. The roadmap began as a group of advocates joining forces to push interconnected legislative action in New York State to address the criminalization of immigrants and migrant communities, The roadmap is a direct guide for New York elected officials to address some of the worst harms caused by this system. And we're going to be joined by some really wonderful voices from RAP, which is the Release Aging People in Prison campaign, NYCLU, and the Center for Community Alternatives, amongst others. So I just wanted to be able to plug that really quickly because the Justice Roadmap group is doing really amazing work, obviously, with all over the place. And it's kind of this really great interconnection between a lot of different organizing efforts in New York right now. And I'll plug that, a link to register for that panel that we'll have next week is now in the chat too. But yeah, beyond that, I think that is where our questions wrap up. But if there was anything else or anything else that you guys wanted to plug on behalf of DSA or Housing Justice for All, feel free to wrap up any final comments, Sia or Sumathy. Any more book recs?
Yeah, any more book recs? Sumathy, when I share our book recs, I'm gonna plug our.
Sure. I think one of them is Ella Baker's biography. What is it called? Oh my God.
Ella Baker. Ella Baker and the Black Freedom Movement.
Yes, that's a great book to like learn how to organize and like how what it's like to be an organizer, especially for like decades and decades from the best. That is one that I would highly recommend. And what were the other ones? I don't remember now. The other book recs.
The other book rec was
the one about the vouchers.
Black Against Empire, which is about the Black Panthers and the different tactics they used. And then the last one that we use is about disciplining the poor, which is about the sort of neoliberalism of welfare programs and the history of welfare programs in the US. All books that you can get from, well, I don't know if you can get them from the library, but maybe the library will get them and then you can get them from the library.
Perfect. Yeah, we'll bug our book orders to make sure that we have these stocked for everyone in coming months. But all really wonderful recommendations that I can sign off on. But yeah, thank you guys both so much for joining us this afternoon. This has been a really fruitful discussion and a lot of skill building and information building that I've taken a lot away from, and I'm sure viewers at home have been able to learn a lot from. And yeah, I'll be able to go back and plug any links that we talked about in the chat. I'll make sure to plug them in the video description. So anyone watching this later on, if the chat isn't active, just check out the description below for some of the links we've mentioned and maybe some of even the book recommendations. And yeah, once again, thanks to both Sia and Sumathy for joining us. And of course, if anyone has any questions, please check out housingjusticeforall.org or get in touch via housingforallny@gmail.com. But everyone else, have a great afternoon. Take care, and we'll see you tomorrow for our workshop on how to know your rights around police interactions. Take care, everyone.
Bye.